Britain is struggling to recover from the worst recession in living memory. To help their businesses bounce back, some bosses are willing to take extreme action.
We've got tough times coming.
We need to be together as a whole workforce to face those challenges.
Each week, we follow the boss of a major corporation as they go undercover in their own organisation. This week, the boss of Tower Hamlets Council in London.
Send him in, great.
With a turnover of £1 billion and 10,500 employees, the council provides a range of services for its residents. From community policing to pest control.
Council, cockroach?
This boss will swap his suit and smartphone.
Just identifies you as a Tower Hamlets employee.
For protective clothing and the city's streets.
Stop begging and move on.
He'll assume a new identity.
Nice to meet you, colleague.
And pose as a trainee, trying out entry-level jobs.
I'm only training. He's qualified. He won't be a minute. He's just coming.
Finally, he'll reveal his true identity. But how will his fellow workers react?
I'm not Colin.
When they find out he's really their boss.
I'm the chief executive of council.
Oh, my God.
Didn't know that.
It'll be a meeting they'll never forget.
I don't know what to say.
I'm totally gobsmacked that that was the chief executive.
Tower Hamlets, in the heart of London's East End, is a borough of stark contrasts, where the nation's richest look down on some of the poorest estates in Britain. For the last four centuries, it's been a magnet for new immigrants. 49% of the population has an ethnic minority background. 49-year-old Kevin Collins is the council's chief executive.
My friends and family would describe me as someone who's fairly driven and fairly competitive. I don't like to lose very often.
Originally from Lancashire, Kevin has been in the job for just 4 months.
Being the chief executive of Tower Hamlets presents a number of challenges. We live in a place which is marked by inequality. We have some of the most successful businesses on our doorstep. And yet when you go to the heart of the borough, all too often, you still see large areas of poverty. And the great challenge is to try and make sure that the wealth that's created is shared.
Kevin is responsible for implementing the policies set by the 51 councillors elected by the residents of Tower Hamlets.
Being the chief executive of a public organisation is a bit different than being the chief executive of a private organisation. My shareholders, if you like, are the people of this borough. I'm responsible for the total workforce, and there's something like 8,000 people that work for the council. We operate over 100 schools. We run social services for both children and adults. We pay housing benefits. We run parking. The list goes on and on and on.
Both Kevin's job and the lives of his constituents is about to get harder.
Look at that one, yeah. And try and work out what's going on there in a bit more detail.
The new government wants to reduce the massive budget deficit, so public services provided by councils are about to be slashed.
This isn't such a good news story here. There will need to be some sort of tightening on public finance. The savings that might be required of us are unprecedented. We think that will mean up to £50 million over a three-year period. It's a lot of money. It's an enormous challenge. I genuinely believe there are efficiencies that we can make. Can we make this many of this scale without there being pain? No. Well,
thanks very much for popping in.
No problem. My job is to make sure that we minimise any impact of cuts on the front line, because if you cut frontline services in a place like Tower Hamlets, you end up the cost being borne by the people who are most vulnerable.
Kevin now lives in the exclusive Spitalfields area of the borough. Becoming chief executive means he's returning to where he started his career.
My connection with Tower Hamlets is sort of deep and enduring. I live here, I work here. I started working for this borough a long time ago as a trainee teacher in a primary school in the Mile End, and I loved that. So my relationship is quite personal with this place.
Kevin's packed a lot into his 25-year career, including a PhD in education and being head of primary school strategy for the Blair government.
I've been working in public service for my whole life, and I guess I've just found a path. I've found something which suits my values, it suits my basic sort of belief system. I was born into a family where my father had been in the army for a long, long time. So I was born into a culture of knowing what it meant to serve. I mean, my mum and dad are both still alive in their mid-80s, and they're very important to me. They are inspirations for me. I think especially their sense of service and dedication to this country. I want the council to get better. And to get better, I think we all need to take a few risks. The risk for me is going undercover.
Before leaving, Kevin calls a meeting with his senior management team.
I think we're all aware in public service that we're facing a difficult time in terms of our finances. We need to be together as a whole workforce to face those challenges. And so I'm going to spend some time working at the front line alongside the staff to understand them, to talk to them, to know them, and feedback from them what their ideas are about how we can make ourselves more efficient.
It always strikes me when I speak to frontline staff the number of ideas that they have themselves. I'll certainly be interested to find out from you some of those insights.
Because I'm sure there's going to be an absolute wealth of information for us to carry on improving and developing this council to be the place we want it to be.
I think also it gives you the opportunity to get out and see what's going on at the coalface.
Kevin is fair. He's got vision, which I think is great for the organisation, and can be quite ruthless sometimes.
Well, good luck.
The time has come for Kevin to leave the town hall and the comforts of his six-figure salary.
All right, bye then, Carol. See you in a couple of weeks.
Now he'll assume his new identity.
To try and make myself less obvious, I've been growing this excuse for a beard for a couple of weeks, and this is over a week's growth, and having my hair cut really short might help.
Do your worst.
Yeah.
For the next week, he'll be known as Colin. His cover story is that he's an unemployed catering worker from Blackpool, trying out entry-level council jobs for a television programme.
Now, I hope that by going undercover, I'm going to understand the organisation better. I'm going to get closer to our staff.
Oh, thanks, Guy.
And I'm going to be able to return with answers how we can do our job better, support those who deliver right at the front line in this council.
It's the first day of Kevin's undercover mission.
What's dawning on me is how serious it is, really. And I've just got to throw myself absolutely into it. I've never done anything like this at all in my life, so, I kind of don't quite know how I'll respond, but I'm obviously going to just give it my best shot.
Kevin has chosen to start with one of the council's vital services, Meals on Wheels.
Oh, hi, it's Colin from Michael Hales.
From its headquarters in Bethnal Green, 450 meals are cooked and delivered to the vulnerable and elderly every single day. The customers only have to pay £2.25 a meal. It's a heavily subsidised service that cost the council £1 million last year. Kevin knows the service has already been the victim of cost-cutting. Budgets have been reduced by £140,000 in the last 2 years.
We've asked the service to become more efficient. I want to see what the impact of that is. And I want to see whether or not there are yet more efficiencies or productivity that we can get out of the way that we provide this service.
Chris, let me introduce you to him. Colin.
Hello.
Colin.
Chris.
Hello.
Hi, pleased to meet you.
I'll be gentle with him.
Thank you very much. That's what I need.
Kevin will be delivering meals to the elderly and vulnerable with 62-year-old grandmother Chris.
And we just put them side by side. Yeah.
They're not light.
Oh, no, they're heavy.
Chris thinks her new assistant, Colin, is just a trainee trying out her job for a television programme.
Are you ready to go? Ready to rumble?
We're excited, actually. Are you the longest person that's been doing it there?
Yeah. 33 years. Last man standing there. Yeah.
Are you local then?
Yeah, Bethnal Green. Where'd you come from?
I come from the north, really, from Lancashire.
I thought your accent.
So I've been working up in
there
for a long time.
You want to work for the council?
I just like the idea of just doing something that, is about helping other. It sounds a bit, funny, but helping other people a bit more.
Yeah. And I'm going to our first drop.
So the A's today are saveloys.
OK.
Right.
So you have to put your dinners in a bag.
OK.
And that just keeps it warm.
Like delivering pizza.
OK. And this is dinner.
There you go.
Mr. Hello,
Easby.
Mr. East.
Quite hot, you okay?
Righto.
Enjoy your lunch.
Bye-bye.
See you, bye-bye.
Bye.
One done. How many did we do?
70.
Wow.
For the meals to arrive hot, each team has a window of just 4 hours to deliver 70 meals across the borough's 1,700 streets.
Hello, I've got your lunch here.
That's one meal every 6 minutes.
OK, get used to it now.
It's fairly quick. Obviously, with these things, that there's a certain amount of business here. You know, we have to cook the meals, we have to deliver them, and that all costs money.
You're late.
Sorry.
And we have to think about how much it's costing us against what we're charging at £2.25 a meal.
Colin, bang loud.
Hello, Mrs. Crawford.
Yeah.
Your lunch. Mrs. Madden.
Oh, yes.
I've got your lunch here.
Although the demand for the service is high, the council has recently cut the number of delivery rounds by 25%.
Did they used to give you more time with them then?
Yeah. When I started, we used to take out about 28 to 30 dinners. It's doubled now. One old lady, she used to have a cup of tea waiting for me. Roughly knew the time I was coming, you know, and it was lovely. Couldn't do that now, just haven't got the time.
Hello, sweetheart.
Hello, Frankie,
right?
Baby. You've got your dinner.
I've got your lunch
here. Do you want to bring it in?
Of course, something nice. That wings. Oh, lovely, lovely. Without you, I don't know what I do.
It's like a little family to me.
All right, me dear.
Yeah, I'll see you tomorrow.
Enjoy that. Nice, sweet.
Come back tomorrow sometime.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. There we go.
Do you think it's a shame you don't get a bit more time with them?
Yeah, I do, because sometimes it's horrible when you've got to run in and run out. And you know they dearly want you to stay for 5 minutes to have a little conversation.
Quite a lot of them would like that, wouldn't they?
Oh, definitely. It's a lot of them. Oh, you see some that have got no one. And I worked at Christmas, over the Christmas period. Oh, come on, in tears.
Really?
Well, you see them, they're having meals, like, the dinner taken to them, and they've got family. And I thought, you know, how can they leave on Christmas Day?
No.
I know not everyone gets on with their family, but how can you leave on Christmas Day?
No, you can't.
Hard, no, isn't it? I just can't even begin to imagine what it must be like not seeing no one, you know, all day.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that is rotten, really.
However, despite the new relentless schedule...
All right, Jess. All right,
hello.
Lads. Got a young chap here today.
Chris finds time to stay on a little longer with frail regulars like 87-year-old Jess.
Yeah.
There you go.
Thank you.
OK.
Yeah.
Do you want me to dish it up for you, or do you want to do it yourself today?
Yeah. If you do. You
want me to do it for you?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I'll go in the sitting room.
Oh, I'll bring you a list for you, Chris.
Oh,
yes.
Thank you, Chris.
What, do you want it on your lap?
Yeah, just have it on your lap.
Yeah? All right, my darling?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
All right, my love.
You don't eat it all now, do you?
You do what you want to do, love. It's up to you. If you don't want to eat it all now...
Enjoy your lunch.
Bye-bye, love.
OK.
It's funny doing this. It makes me think about my mum and dad. With my mum, my dad's 84, my mum's 82.
Yeah.
And they're together, you know, they're still...
Oh, that's nice, isn't it? They've still got one another.
They're still around, they're still up and at it.
Yeah. My mum's 87, she's on her own now. But she cooks all her own meals. Lucky, really.
When I see the relationships that Chris obviously has with the people...
Hello.
It is a shame that for financial reasons, we're not able to dedicate more time.
Thanks very much. Have a nice day.
But Meals on Wheels is obviously about a lot more than just delivering a dinner and walking away. For many of our elderly and more vulnerable people...
See ya. Bye.
It's a lifeline.
It's been a real eye-opener, actually.
I didn't,
like you said earlier to me, I didn't quite expect it to be as...
No, I said it does open your eyes,
yeah.
What goes on with the old people.
It does. Yeah. And they're so grateful and so nice about it. So, you know, it feels like you're doing something worthwhile. Going out with Meals on Wheels is really good for me because it reminds you that when you are looking for your efficiencies and when you're making them...
That's it, that goes for going there.
There is a cost, a real cost.
This first day has reaffirmed Kevin's desire to try to protect the most vulnerable of the borough from the budget cuts he'll have to implement.
Those people don't, in my view, carry any responsibility for the credit crunch. These aren't people who took massive bonuses. They're people who live vulnerable lives, and I think it would be a crying shame on us as a society if they were people who ended up facing the consequences of those actions.
Facing the prospect of having to make massive budget cuts, Kevin Collins, chief executive of Tower Hamlets Council, is on a special mission. He's working undercover on the front line to try and find ways of making his money go further and keep vital services going.
Doing it this way, you're seeing it as it is rather than as people want you to see it. Because I think the minute people know that you're a senior manager or you're the chief executive, they just put on a different kind of show.
Today, Kevin's decided to work at the Housing and Homelessness Office, which aims to find accommodation for the homeless and help those at risk of losing their homes.
One of the largest social challenges we're facing is housing, because we're only 8 square miles and we're 200,000 people. We're crowded and we don't have enough housing to meet everybody's needs.
The population has rocketed by 33% in 2 decades, so resources are pushed to breaking point. Last year, 2,000 people were registered homeless.
Homelessness is a massive issue for us. And I'm going to be interested to see just how we handle that overwhelming demand against such limited supply.
Kevin is going to work on the front line on the reception desk to see if any improvements can be made to ease this desperate situation.
Are you currently homeless?
I want to see whether the service we provide is good enough. I want to see that people are treated with respect. I want to see what it's like at the sharp end.
This is the first point of contact with the council for anyone at risk of becoming homeless. It's a place where emotions often run high.
Oh, nice.
Hello,
to meet you,
Colin. Another colleague.
Nice to meet you. Hi.
Yeah, another colleague.
Colin's going to just spend the day with us,
okay.
Show him the ropes.
Kevin will be working with 25-year-old Malachi.
Oh, great. Oh, that's good to hear. I brought my coat here, is that all right?
Yeah, that's perfectly fine.
Together, they'll direct clients to the appropriate housing officer, who will handle their case.
Hi, good morning.
Can I speak to someone from the homeless department, please?
Okay, have you been here before?
I've been to the housing benefit office and they've told me I need to see someone from the homeless department.
All right, I've got to see the housing benefit team. So
take a seat, we'll call you in shortly.
Okay, thank you.
We can select homeless reception, because that's initially what we always use.
To do the job properly, Kevin will have to master the computerised system.
That's the applicant's name, and we just confirmed that with them before we actually initialise the select.
And get to grips with the housing priority process.
Find out whether they're single or a couple, whether they have children. By doing that, we find out whether they're a priority or not.
There's a lot to learn.
It is quite a bit. Good morning, would you like to come over?
Families, people with children and the vulnerable have priority over others on the housing list.
So I'm going to be evicted.
Is it just for yourself?
Yeah? Yes, it is, yeah.
Excellent. All right, so if you take a seat, they'll call your name shortly on the tannoy.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Take care.
But it's not all people like really down on their luck. I mean, some people sort of...
You can get made homeless almost through anything. You get what I'm saying? Like, your mortgage can go wrong or the job which you're used to being in, you've been terminated. Circumstances that's unforeseen most of the time, isn't it? So,
like you say, it can happen to anybody.
Yes, that's right.
But the service can't help everyone. Single people without children, like 23-year-old Jack, are a low priority.
How can we help?
I've got ADHD, mate. I ain't on my tablets today. If I don't get nowhere to go, I've got mad. You know
no,
I mean?
We don't want that, man.
And it's just going to send me nuts.
No,
yeah. And I don't want that. No one wants that. You know what I'm like, you know I'm humble,
cool.
You know
yeah,
I'm like, man, it's just
so
some
cool.
Things that just happen, it just triggers me off, man, and I can't help that.
No, you're really cool, man.
People get really nasty with really. You.
In their mind, they know they have to go back out into the cold or try and find an alternative place to sleep. That's when the frustration and the anger builds up and they may come out and take out a reception.
Mr. John Ed, 3 cubicles 6, please, John
Ed,
3 cubicles.
That's
have
cool.
You noticed I gave Jack some water so you can just kind of see that we've got a relationship between them. Like, I'm having a water and you're having a water. We're drinking the kind of same drink from the same kind of cups
and everything
like that. In their mind, mentally, it just shows them that like, it's a form of connection.
I think having the right temperament at the moment when you're first met sets a tone.
Is it just for yourself?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent.
What I really like about Malachi is the way that
people come in at all different stages of stress, and yet he calms it down.
Malachi's job is a juggling act, as Kevin discovers when it's his turn.
And your first name is?
Yeah. Me, Dolly.
I need to go back and check the date of birth. It's not there. Yeah. I'm sorry, it's me. What type of appointment is here for? Housing advice, that's right. So if you take a seat, your name will be called. Sorry, it took a bit of a long time. Who's next?
I want the top dog. Yeah. I am not going to settle for second best.
That's understandable, sir.
You're not talking to like a civilian, you're talking to Barrister. I'm not happy with this. I've been here week after week.
The fact that you're actually waiting is because he's dealing with paperwork for you. Otherwise, he would have finished with your case and told you we wouldn't be able to help you.
Well, he could have just sorted it out and sent a letter saying...
It does take a bit of time.
Go back to the hotel. It's costing you more money to put me in a hotel. Mm. Why not just give me a flat?
It's fully understandable. I'll find out your case and then I'll come back and see you shortly, yeah?
Right, well, if you don't, then I certainly will be taking it straight to Stratford Magistrates Court. Mm. Your bosses won't be happy.
I've been noticing with you, I mean, people come in and you show a bit of respect.
Because they're humans like us, really. Like, you just got to know that you could be in that predicament one day yourself.
Malachi started working at the Housing and Homelessness Office 2 months ago, shortly after becoming a father for the first time.
The baby puts a smile on my face. Yeah. You got kids of your own?
No, I haven't got any kids.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much.
So how did you find it this morning?
I didn't think it'd be quite as calm and as quiet and as, you know?
Yeah, do you feel the sentimental part to it where you feel like, you know what, I need to give them that extra help rather than what the council's actually providing, because that little bit extra help there just always makes me that much more happy.
Is that all, have you always been like that?
My friends through my life growing up, I've seen where they fell off the rails, and some's gone to drugs, some's turned to alcohol, some's just gone to just not working at all. So I'm saying to myself, like, the best bet for me now is to be in the field myself where I can actually give that direct help, because I know myself that I'll follow everything through to make sure, like, there's a very good result. Take a seat here, and they'll call your name on the tannoy. All right.
Okay. All right. You have to listen for your name.
All right.
So how long have you been doing
since,
all of this?
I've been here since November, but I'm currently on a temporary contract. A lady went away on maternity leave.
Okay. And we don't know when she's coming back.
No.
But ideally, you'd want to stay, would you, if you could?
I would. Yeah. Definitely. Definitely.
Yeah, I can see you enjoy it. Well, it's, you know, no, I like enjoy what you do. It's great, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Today, I confirmed with real people what I already know from the data, that it is relentless. But seeing it in the flesh makes it obviously more real.
You need to take a seat and they'll call your name on the time limit.
I also felt quite proud of the organisation today. I thought that, you know, if we weren't doing this, who would do it?
Thank you. All right, take care.
There are questions, of course. Once you get on the computer, is the system as slick as it could be? I don't think so. Could we make it a bit faster and a bit smoother? Yes.
Thank you ever so much. You've got to do it again sometime.
Yeah, well, I will.
You better not be on the other side when you come back.
We can't solve everybody's problem. We certainly couldn't house everybody who came in homeless. What we can do is put them into a transparent and fair system and treat them with the respect they deserve at that moment.
Saturday afternoon.
Fuck the police!
Kevin's borough has one of the highest rates of antisocial behaviour in the capital. So he's going undercover to assess the latest initiative to tackle this problem. Set up 4 months ago, this scheme has cost the council £750,000.
The Town Homeless Enforcement Officers are a new approach for us that we've set up here with the Metropolitan Police.
This is Colin. He's going to be working with us today. He's going to be working with Dale and Mark today.
With cuts looming and under pressure to account for every penny, Kevin needs to know if this costly fledgling scheme is working on the ground.
OK, your stab vests are very important. Make sure you've got them outside your fleeces, please, today.
Do you just put that out? Yeah. Just slip it over.
Slightly apprehensive.
Okay. Here we are.
I guess every time you go out, you don't quite know what you're going to encounter. You don't know what it could escalate to.
How's that feel? Okay.
The enforcement officers have had 2 months training with the Metropolitan Police to prepare them for life on the front line.
Oh, what's your name again?
Colin.
If we are in a situation, it'd be good for you just to take a step back.
Right, you are.
Mark is a 41-year-old ex-police officer, and his colleague, 44-year-old local Dell, used to be a traffic warden.
What is that short for? Delroy?
No. My name is Mama's Armit, but it's a tongue twister.
On the 10-hour shift, Kevin can expect to see the range of antisocial behaviour the officers tackle most weekends.
You drink methadone?
Yeah.
From aggressive begging to littering.
Don't worry about them, just pick your litter up.
So what powers, what's the difference between what you do in life and policemen or something?
Well, the police can do all these things, but you don't really want policemen coming around sticking people on for littering, dog fouling,
right,
and things like that. You want them out, you know, doing the real sort of crime.
Remember, no drinking on the streets here.
We also have powers to take alcohol off people in drinking control zones.
You're not allowed to, what, just drink anything?
You're not allowed to drink from an open container.
Right.
Alcohol.
Right, I see. OK.
In the whole area.
Right, right.
2 hours on the beat, and just a few streets from Kevin's home, the enforcement officers come across a potentially challenging situation.
Yeah, 5501, we're down Barlock, Steve, about 35 youth, Asian. They're walking towards Whitechapel Road, over.
It's like there are like 12-year-old kids hanging around there.
And these 12-year-old kids are normally out here till about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And they are actually causing antisocial behaviour around here. And it's affecting the quality of life of these people in this building.
Right. How serious does it get?
There was a stabbing here, not last week, the weekend before.
Get away from these people's houses and respect them, all right? Let's go.
It was a tense and potentially difficult situation which could easily have gone wrong if it hadn't been handled with authority.
If you move out of here quick, we can clean the area.
They're into doing this properly. They're into being firm when you need to with some of the young lads and say, come on, we need you out of here.
The thing is, we've actually shown a presence. They know we're here, so they're going to keep the volume down.
And the residents have seen us.
And the residents have seen us.
After the gang disperses, the officers approach an illegal street trader.
This one's going to be a warning. The next one, we will issue a fixed penalty notice, OK?
This is selling stuff without
a trading licence.
If you sell anything, you've got to be able to...
You need to have a licence. All these people have got licences to trade. We're actually taking her details, giving her a warning, so if we see her again, we're going to issue a fixed penalty notice for her.
I know what you're doing.
Yeah. What is it that we're doing here? What do you think we're doing with this lady?
She's like a balloon lady, making little balloons.
I worked that bit out, yeah.
Giving them to people.
Giving them to people.
And then they're giving them a donation back.
A donation? All she needs is a temporary street trader's licence.
That's the man's
name. Like everybody else down here.
Is it really necessary? You could be in a rush to be doing something else.
Yeah.
Turn the blind eye, really. Well,
can't do that, I'm afraid. We can't be discriminant to anything. We need to be professional and do our job.
But you can say that about the Third Reich.
The clowns let off with a warning. But Dell's not so lenient with another offender. He spots dropping a cigarette butt.
Right, can I have a quick word with you? I'm a Tower Hamlets enforcement officer. Yeah. I've just noticed that you've just chucked your litter down the drain, which is an offence. So I'm going to give you a fixed penalty notice, which is a fine. OK?
He just has to pay, like, it's like getting a parking ticket.
He's got 14 days to pay. If he pays within 10 days, it's £50. If he pays within 14 days, it's £80.
Finding someone for putting cigarette ends down the drain. Is that the good use of our time?
Do you understand the caution,
yeah,
sir?
Of course, yeah.
And the offence that you're just committed.
I can see the real need for the service, but we don't seem at the moment to be doing it in a way that I can quite understand the decisions we've made.
Most expensive cigarette you've had for a long time, yeah?
Exactly. Finding somebody dropping a cigarette end down while warning somebody who's illegally trading dressed as a clown. So that is the area that I need to learn more about and understand better.
With Kevin unsettled by the inconsistency of his enforcement officer's decisions, they move from the Whitechapel Road to their next patch, Brick Lane.
All right, mate. Hello, mate. All right. I'm asking you to stop begging and move on.
Now, what level of enforcement do we really want?
It's empty your faith.
We're asking lots of people to walk down a street with the plethora of powers and laws and bylaws that are available and make judgments on the run.
about when you're going to enact them and when you're going to warn somebody. And these are moments of decision making which change your relationship to the citizen.
Shall I have a piss?
Just stay here a sec, Mark.
I did see examples of where there was a lack of consistency in the enforcement approach. And we've got to keep talking about that and thinking about that.
John Packy, you can't smash me in the face.
Say that again and I'll have you nicked. Don't mention that word again,
OK? Right,
because... You're not a real police, are
you? No.
You're plastic.
I wish I was.
I think it's about being reliable and consistent. Otherwise, I think you're open to all sorts of challenge.
Kevin is in the middle of his undercover mission.
I am tired. I'm finding it quite intensive. I think the whole thing about being in the role, developing a relationship, being observed, thinking at all sorts of levels all of the time, I'm finding obviously quite tiring.
Kevin's under pressure to justify every pound spent on the front line. And so today, he's going to assess the pest control department to see if it offers value for money. It's a service most London boroughs contract out to private firms to cut costs. Keeping it in-house takes £800,000 a year out of Kevin's budget.
Tip.
Hello, Colin.
Hello.
Hi,
Colin's Tip. With you for the day. Okay, if you can just show him through the ropes what we know.
Kevin will be working with Tim, a 50-year-old divorcee, who's devoted himself to ridding the borough of pests for 17 years.
That's for you, a wear a day.
Oh, right, okay.
You'll need that. Just identifies you as a Tower Hamlets employee.
Oh, right, you are.
Tim prepares his new assistant, not knowing that he's the council's chief executive.
I've worked for four councils.
Right. And how does this one shape up?
This council, I've been here 17 years, and I? So it's the longest one I've worked for, and I've thoroughly enjoyed it.
In Tower Hamlets, pest complaints are growing by 10% a year. In 2009 alone, the department dealt with 26,000 cases, ranging from bedbug infestations to venomous snakes.
Where we're going to now is a rat problem, yeah.
Are rats the number one?
Rats are, yeah, that's really the bread and butter of what we're all about, really.
Last year, 1,800 call-outs were for rats.
And my first job was to deal with a rat in a garden. The first one I had to bash,
You trap them back?
No, this one's dying.
Right.
They squeak and they squeal. Horrible. We'll take that. Now we're in business.
Went to take my rubbish out like I normally do.
Yeah.
As I shut the door, one ran out and I saw it run up them stairs and I thought, well, if it can get up and downstairs, it can get up in mine, you know, and I would die.
Absolutely.
I wouldn't live here no more if a rat got in his house. Absolutely. And I thought, oh, my God, like, you know, they could eat me.
Unlikely that rats have extremely poor eyesight. So, and they're colour blind, so they ain't going to see that we've got nice bright yellow jackets and you've got a grey coat on. So basically they'll see a black hole and that's what they want to get down to. We're on the case. You're a bit like a detective, really.
Yeah.
At a scene of a crime. We have this hedge, and if you come down here now, you tell me what you see.
There's a hole. There's
exactly.
A hole.
So that's where our rats are coming from.
Yeah.
We're going to put some bait down that hole.
OK.
So if you want to drop that in there...
Kevin is used to setting board-level strategies, but setting rat traps is a far cry from his day job.
Oh, I can sort of block the hole, that all right?
Excellent, that's fantastic. That's exactly what we want.
Oh, right, good. Tim knows his business inside out, he's interested in it, he's incredibly thorough, and I'm really enjoying being with him. I'm learning a lot.
Thanks.
Tim believes his job is not just to poison the rats, but to try to find the source of the problem.
See that little bung there? If it's missing, it allows rats to come from the main sewer system into these systems, and then they break out.
Right.
By stopping the source of the rats, Tim can prevent expensive repeat call-outs and save the council money.
But does every council like have a pest control service?
Some farm it out to a company, a pest control company.
Oh, right.
Private companies probably wouldn't do the drainage bit we've done.
Because it's not with them?
Nope. Whereas it's part and parcel of what we've done. You know, we're not there to make a profit.
No.
We're providing a service.
What Tim's just told me and what I've kind of observed watching him at work is what we run is a kind of whole service, which allows us to get to the causes as well as the symptoms.
Oh, look, there's an found one. Massive hole.
And I've got to think about whether you'd get such a whole service if it was commissioned out.
Oh, we've seen rat droppings.
Tim may have shown Kevin the value of keeping the operation in-house.
So this is clearly a job we need to come back on and keep a check on.
Another one solved.
Tim has definitely got untapped potential. The test for us, of course, is how do we get the full potential out of Tim?
Does the council take people on and
train them? Some do. Tower Hamlets, generally not.
Oh, right.
I think this experience is reminding me how important the people are. It demonstrates to me that the right people can do anything, and that's what really, really matters.
...8 a.m. It's Kevin's last day undercover, and he's going to focus on a disappearing East End institution. Street markets have been the lifeblood of the community and local economy since the 16th century.
Thank you.
But with fierce competition from supermarkets and shopping centres, the markets are in decline. In 5 years, the number of traders has dropped by a third, and income has fallen by 20%.
Today I'm going to try my hand at being a market officer. Markets are really important to the future of the borough and to its economy. So I'm looking forward to seeing how the market officers are trying to deal with that, how they're trying to get life back into it, more people going there, and are we supporting the stallholders to regenerate the markets?
Today, Kevin will be working with 32-year-old market officer Shaz, a married father of one who grew up in Tower Hamlets.
How much experience have you got regards to... None. OK. I look forward to showing you around.
Right, great.
Shaz and Kevin will inspect all 120 pitches at Whitechapel Market. It's a popular Asian market, and it holds a special place in Shaz's heart, as he's the son of Bangladeshi immigrants.
I used to be a little kid, I used to be in the markets. I never thought then...
You worked on them?
I used to come and do shopping.
Right.
And I never used to thought, like, I would be doing this myself. You got your ID badge with you, sir?
Yeah.
At the market, they make sure there's nothing to put off shoppers.
You cannot display goods directly on the ground. Can you please make sure that is off the floor? But we do have to make him realise it does matter, and that's why we are here.
Yeah.
This rail needs to go a bit back, please. Thank you very much.
Shaz's approach is to try and maximise the business, and he understands that if the market is orderly, he'll get more people using the markets and more revenue for the market traders. He seems to have their interest at heart.
Do you have a licence plate?
Yeah, yeah.
That's your plate. Great. Right. Well, have you got any ID, Ms. Mahmood?
Yeah.
I'm just cracking on. Is that all right?
I'm leaving it to you.
Yeah, well,
I'm taking a break.
It's the ID bit.
He is managing all by himself, and I'm really proud of him. I think he should join us. To me, I find pride in what I do with Dunner Design.
Yeah.
That would make the market a place where people want to come more rather than go somewhere else. This is the idea which came up, how the market can be improved. You know, if we had the funding, this is what we would like to see.
What's that all about, though?
This is like the Olympics coming, so it's the Olympic boulevard, you know, it's the stretch which goes
wow.
on. It would increase employment. It would benefit the community.
Yeah.
It would make Tower Hamlets more famous, not just within the country, but worldwide.
Yeah. So you've just done all this yourselves.
We spent hours just to get these ideas together, obviously not during working hours.
What made you even kind of want to put the effort into...
Because I've been living here so long all my life, and I still live in Tower Hamlets. See, if I can make a difference, it would be an achievement which I can then retire and look back and say, look, I had involvement.
Who is it that makes the decision?
The chief ex of Tower Hamlets Council.
Obviously, I didn't ask all the horrible questions you've got to ask about stacking it up financially and then all the rest of it. But on the surface, it just looks so great that people have done that at work in their own time.
It's the end of Kevin's time undercover.
It's so important in life to feel that there's a kind of moral purpose about what you do, and I've always needed that, and I've always had that, and this has just kind of given it another shot, if you like. I'm going back with a new energy, I'm going back with new knowledge, And I'm going back with a new appreciation, I think, a renewed appreciation of why I do what I do.
Next, Kevin returns to his job as chief executive and reveals his true identity to the employees.
I'm not Colin. I'm not looking for a job.
God.
After working undercover on the front line, Kevin Collins is back at the town hall, returning to his job as chief executive.
I think I'm going to miss lots of what I've been doing and miss the people, but it's great to be back doing what I want to do and doing the job that I'm here to do.
The employees who worked with Kevin have been summoned to head office. But they haven't been told why.
Colin.
Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Remember me then?
I do.
Oh, you look lovely.
Hello, Chris.
Hello, look at you. What's going on?
Well, I'm not Colin.
You're not Colin.
I'm not Colin.
Oh, my God.
I'm the chief executive of the council here in Tower Hamlets.
Oh.
Chris, I just thought you were fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
I thought your dedication and commitment to our older vulnerable people was just absolutely brilliant. And I think the way you do it with such a laugh and they know you and they, you know, it's great. It's really, really great. Because I was just so struck by your care, I wanted to ask you if you'd do something for me. We're working, you know, here as a council, as you know, to think about how do we better support our older people. And we're developing a kind of very innovative, new, cutting-edge approach to helping people to stay independent and be independent for longer.
Yeah.
And I want you to be part of it. I want you to be part of the team because of, you know, what you know about our older people, the way that you're so special with them. And I wondered if you'd be up for that.
Yeah, I'd be honoured.
Yeah, because you're... Thanks, Chris. It's lovely to meet you.
Yeah, and you. Thank you.
Great.
Made me feel brilliant. At least all these years I've worked, I feel I am appreciated. I still can't get over it. I'm still in shock, really. I can't believe it. How he fooled me.
Your work ethic is absolutely outstanding, Malachi.
Oh, thank you very much.
And I know that at the moment the contract you've got with us isn't a permanent contract.
Yeah, unfortunately.
And yet you're exactly the kind of person, you know, that I want to see working in Tower Hamlets. No doubt about that in my mind at all.
Thank you, yeah.
Because you've got a great career in public service, I'm sure of that. And I wanted to offer you something and see what you think. Maybe I could offer to become your sort of personal mentor.
Wow.
Come and meet you, say, every fortnight and talk about some of the opportunities, your career planning and the way you're putting it together.
That'll be
and
wonderful.
See if I can help you.
Dude. Colin, I'd appreciate it. It'll be a wonderful...
It's Kevin. Oh,
see, I'm still stuck in the mould. I'm ecstatic, excited, having a lot of mixed emotions and feelings at the same time. It's a good choice I made coming to Tower Hamlets, I guess.
Tim? Your passion for what you do is so clear. All this world opens up that I didn't know about.
I could say that.
And I thought that was great. I first started as a teacher.
Right.
And what was really interesting to me was that, you know, you're obviously a natural teacher. And I think that ability to teach is, you know, it's quite inspirational. So I wanted to talk to you about an idea. I'd like you to head up an apprenticeship scheme for me. Where we can get local young people as enthusiastic as you into the world of pest control.
I'm just shocked.
Are you?
Because I didn't know who you were. I am shocked, yeah. Thank you very much.
No, it's an absolute privilege to work with you. You're a good man.
I was quite emotional just then, really. You know, you don't get that sort of thing happen every day. And for me to be chosen as the one, absolutely fantastic.
Del, Mark. The enforcement office is a relatively new thing in the council. What's interesting for me is you walk down Whitechapel High Street or walk up Brick Lane, and actually every step of the way there are kind of four or five things you could do. And I think it's really quite tough, this decision about when you act and when you don't and when you show the discretion.
Each individual works differently. You've got to just make your own decision up there and then, really.
But what came to me was that, and while the enforcement team is new, that there's a kind of window where we've got to really ask the question, are we clear about the consistency of when we make the decisions? You know, the discretion we're asking you to use before we roll it out and get more and more people in.
And so I want to convene a panel which includes the leader of the council, the borough commander of police, me, some residents, and I want you two to be on it. What I'm hoping that this panel will do is just help us firm up a bit more what it is we all expect of the role. So I think it's such an important thing for us to get right. It's going to be so important for the borough, I think, in the future to get the enforcement team right. And I just wondered whether you were up for that.
How could we possibly say no?
I've been working for a council a long time and this has never happened to me. It's about time someone listened.
Hello, Shaz. Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Now then, do you remember who I am?
Yes, you're the chief ex of Tahamers.
How do you know that?
Well, I've seen your picture on the website.
But what were you doing yesterday, though? What happened yesterday?
Yesterday, I was involved with some film activity on Watchpool Market.
Right.
With Colin. You know, he was going for... Oh, my God. No. No. Colin.
Yeah.
I didn't recognise you. I'm sorry. Went through the whole day with you not knowing the other chief ex, and I thought you were Colin. Oh, God.
When we got back to the office and you showed me the stuff that you and your team and your colleagues and friends had done in your own time about the future of Whitechapel Market, I was blown away. I thought it was fantastic. So I want to get you to join the 2012 delivery group. I want you to come to it and be part of you, yeah? I want you...
No.
Yeah.
Seriously?
No, seriously, I want you to come and be part of it because I want you to make sure the market and that bit of Whitechapel High Street is really well represented.
Wow.
Because you were telling me, and of course I know, that how important the Olympics is to us and to East London.
Thank you. I'd love to do it. This is it. Thanks to Colin. I mean, thanks to Kevin for giving me the chance. And, yeah, it's a great opportunity, you know, and I'm shocked and amazed and pleased and so happy. I don't know what to say, you know. I feel like jumping. Yeah, wicked. Yeah.
I'm really happy that I've done this. I'm really happy on all sorts of levels that I've done this. Incredibly grateful for how generous all the people were that worked with me. We're lucky, we have some really great people that work for us. And I've just had the chance to spend time with them. I'm feeling proud, really, of where I work, who I work with, and what I do.
Next time, a massive challenge for the chief executive of Harry Ramsden's, Britain's oldest fish and chip chain.
I've never been a waitress before.
Oh.
It's unacceptable. It is a joke.
This Sunday at 8, what happens when Amish kids are let loose in London? The world's squarest teenagers, a unique insight into a hidden world. Well, next tonight, the stage is set, the leg warmers are on, and a special guest gets things moving in Big Brother.